Hey Timberline, as I always say, it is a good day to be alive, because it is. No matter what's going on in the world around us, God is sovereign, He is in control, and it is a good day to praise Him. And sometimes He surprises us, like snow on May 9th, and sometimes He gives us really fun things to celebrate, like Mother's Day. So wherever your mother is today, whether she's near, far, or maybe she's passed on, today's a good day to be thankful and to celebrate mothers. So Courtney Christman is going to be with us today, and she's going to be sharing part of the message and encouraging us to do all things to the glory of God. So obviously that's not just a message for mothers, that's a message for all of us. But before we get there, we're going to be celebrating with some funny videos to appreciate how much we appreciate our mothers and all the work that they do. And also, if you're a mother, just keep your eyes open for the blessings that might show up today.
Just give me 1 second, thank
sure.
you, sorry. Uh-huh, hey, hi. 2 minutes, thank you. Hi, good afternoon, sorry about
hey,
that.
Hey,
hi, nice
Hi.
To meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. Have you ever done one of these interviews over the camera before?
No.
Well, let me tell you a little bit about the job to get started with. It's not just a job, it's sort of probably the most important job. The title that we have going right now is Director of Operations, but it's really kind of so much more than that. Responsibilities and requirements are really quite extensive. First category for the requirements would be mobility. This job requires that you must be able to work standing up most or really all of the time, constantly on your feet, constantly bending over, constantly exerting yourself, a high level of stamina.
Okay.
That's a lot.
For how many hours?
135 hours to unlimited hours a week. It's basically 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
I'm sure you'll have a chance from time to time to maybe just sit down here and there, yeah?
You mean like a break?
Yeah.
No, there are no breaks available.
Is that even legal?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So like no lunch?
You can have lunch, but only when the associate is done eating their lunch.
I think that's a little intense.
No.
Not possible.
That's crazy.
Now, this position requires excellent negotiation and interpersonal skill. We're really looking for someone that might have a degree in medicine, in finance, and the culinary arts. You must be able to wear several hats. Associate needs constant attention. Sometimes they have to stay up with an associate throughout the night. Being able to work in a chaotic environment, if you had a life, we'd ask you to sort of give that life up. No vacations. In fact, Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, and holidays, the workload is gonna go up, and we demand that. With a happy disposition.
That's almost cruel. That's almost a very, very sick, twisted joke.
But when there's time to sleep, or...
Oh, no time to sleep.
Yeah, all-encompassing, almost.
That's exactly right.
365 days a year?
Yes.
No, that's inhumane.
That's very insane.
The meaningful connections that you make and the feeling that you get from really helping your associate are immeasurable. Also, let's cover the salary. The position is going to pay absolutely nothing.
Excuse me?
No. Nobody's doing that for free.
Yeah, pro bono. Completely for free.
No!
What if I told you there's someone that actually currently holds this position right now? Billions of people, actually.
Who?
Moms.
Yeah.
Yeah. Moms.
That's awesome.
And they meet every requirement,
oh,
don't
wow.
they?
Oh my God. Moms are the best!
Yeah, there's no pay. They're 24 hours, they're always there.
Now I'm thinking about my mom.
Yeah, and what are you thinking about her?
I'm thinking about all those nights and everything.
Thank you so much for everything you do. I know it doesn't seem like I appreciate all of it, but I definitely do.
So, Mom, I want to say thank you for everything that you've done. I love you very much. You've been there through thick and thin. My mom is just awesome. She's awesome.
Well, Benji asked me to share what God has been teaching me through all this. And before everything got crazy, I was just feeling really burnt out and stressed out and not very rested. And I just kept thinking, if only things would slow down and I would have a break from school, then I would finally have like some relief and feel less stressed and feel more rested. And as it turns out, I kind of got my wish, not in the most ideal way, but everything slowed down and I've been teaching from home, and somehow, despite having all this extra time for rest, I still felt very stressed and not as rested as you would expect. And so I was like, my goodness, like if I can't feel rested right now when I have no work to be driving off to early in the morning, then how am I ever gonna feel rested? And so it got me into this whole, like, what is rest? What does true rest look like and how do you get it? And this psalm that I just can't get out of my head for the past few months is Psalm 91, specifically the first verse, which is, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And after reading that over and over and over again, the word that really stood out to me was dwell. I think a lot of times when we think of rest, we think of it as a very passive thing, which is accurate. We think of like laying on the couch and not thinking about much and not doing anything. But in order to get to that place of true rest, the way that God means for it to be, we have to first choose to dwell in the right place. And so for some people, like dwelling, like it looks different, like where are you dwelling? It could be like a physical refuge or a place. For me, I had to think about where my thoughts were dwelling and where was I letting my mind dwell. And when I really started to focus on that, I realized probably like 80-90% of the time, my thoughts were really riddled with like, I don't know, just fear and excessive planning and worry and criticism and negativity instead of admirable, lovely, noble things. So what has God been teaching me? He's been teaching me to take all of these thoughts captive and make them obedient to Christ in order to keep my own mind from hijacking this rest that God meant for us. So I don't know if you can relate to that at all. I don't know if you've been feeling that way at all, but I would just encourage you to ask yourself, where are you choosing to dwell right now? And ask the Holy Spirit what might be hijacking your rest right now. So anyway, miss you all so much.
Hello, Timberline. I'm Michelle Williams. I wish I could invite you to my table and serve you a warm bowl of soup and some fresh bread and ask how your day went. But since I can't, I brought the mom team to bring you some encouragement. Life has been pretty normal for us in many ways. School and garden, grumbles over who has the most dishes to wash, dirty socks and mud in the kitchen, and varying degrees of excitement.
We can't go to church, so why would I need to take a shower on Saturday night?
Jesus has provided me a Lego mask and a bike.
What are you thankful for? What did Jesus provide for you, Abby?
Gummies and fishies.
Gummies and fishies, that was very special.
The Lord has been watching over us. Groceries delivered to our door without me even seeking them out. Just when I needed them. As if someone had read my grocery list. God's care is specific. Calls from far and near. Do you need anything? God's care is never limited. Then came a huge turkey. In a time of drought, God sent us a feast.
God gave us a lot of bacon, and I love bacon. And it's been hard for me because I don't like to wear masks. Just because it's not me, and it's been a struggle, but it's working.
I'm thankful that I'm homeschooled, especially during this quarantine. I've missed church and youth group and Sunday school, but I've enjoyed doing youth group over Zoom, even though it's not the same as getting together with everybody. and I've enjoyed the devotions that Benji's had us do. They've made a lot of things stick out to me that wouldn't normally stick out.
I have been digging through the songs of celebration that the children of Israel sang after God's many victories for them, miracle after miracle. And then one day, a gold nugget jumped off the page at me. Cast your burden on the Lord, from Psalm 55. From the beginning of time, our God has commanded us to put our burdens on Him. Then the generations roll on and on to the Savior of the New Testament. And again, the Savior says, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. 1 Peter 5. Normalcy has been broken, and we have been given the gift of sitting on the edge of a miracle every single day, waiting on God alone. He is our waymaker. Perspective can be our passport or our prison. So wash those hands, wear that mask, and go live a better broken.
Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 to 21. Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands. It is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. I wonder if other moms feel like an invisible mother sometimes. My hands are dry from washing bottles for the sixth time today. I flipped the laundry twice before lunch, and I picked up that toy truck off of the middle of the living room floor for the 100th time, just to have my oldest two fight and scream at each other about who had it first, when in fact it was me. I had it first. It's my turn to play with the toy. Full disclosure, I would not change my situation for anything. My babies are my world, and my husband, most of you know him, is pretty awesome. And in fact, I find myself to be pretty lucky because of how helpful and selfless he is. So, what I'm going to say in my thoughts, I want to make it clear that this is not how I feel every day. If I'm being honest with myself, I do tend to let my emotions and my mood for the day affect my feelings, which then affects how I perceive any situation. And I'm human, so I do allow that to happen. Is it fair? No. But does it happen to me? Yes. So now that we've gotten that preface out of the way, we can move on. A few weeks back, I crawled into bed, my body ready to crash, my mind reeling from the day. Did I get everything done that I needed to? Do I have everything ready for the kids to go? Did I even do anything meaningful today? Did I even eat lunch? I can't remember. I'm lying there and I find myself getting annoyed and frustrated. And I think to myself, I feel like I was invisible today. I feel like nobody even noticed me or anything that I did. I can't stop thinking about how unfair it felt. While I was cleaning the dishes from dinner, the dinner that I had cooked, while my hubby got to play Wii with our oldest, my two-year-old screaming behind me for milk, can't she see that I'm busy doing something else right now? And the baby, of course, he needed a diaper change at that moment, but he was just gonna have to wait until the dishes were done. Then I remember reading a story about a woman who was also feeling the frustrations of the expectations of daily life as a mom. She was annoyed and felt invisible like me. But then a friend of hers had given her a book. And inside was a story about a rich man who visited a cathedral while it was being built. He came across one of the workmen inside, and the workman was diligently working on carving a bird into one of the beams. The rich man couldn't understand why he was spending so much time on this bird. And he looked up and he said to the workman, "Why do you spend so much time carving the bird into a beam? Nobody's going to see it. It will be hidden by the roof." The workman simply responded, "Because God sees it." Whoa. Talk about being humbled. After reading the story, the woman remarked that she felt a piece missing from her life just fall into place. And after reading her story, I began to feel a little bit guilty. But then I remembered that God, he doesn't want me to feel guilt or shame for my frustrations. He used her story to help me realize that what I do every day for my family is not simple, mundane, or meaningless. It's important to him. It is crucial to building the kingdom of God. And just like the workman was adding to the beauty of the cathedral, I have been blessed with the opportunity and the responsibility to care for my family, to make sure that their needs are taken care of so that they can grow to be God's hands and feet. I am able to give my hubby a few moments of wind down time after a busy day of work. I have been given the gift to be able to watch my husband play and teach my son how to take turns, encourage someone else, and how to take interest in others and their successes. I am blessed to have a toddler who can advocate for herself and a need, and the chance to teach her how to use that skill to advocate for others who may not have a voice in the world. And even the stinky diaper, yes, the stinky diaper too, even that, even a baby can learn to love unconditionally by experiencing it from a caregiver who takes the time to care for them. I have a job, a purpose bestowed upon me by God to bring up and prepare His children to go out into the world and proclaim His name. Do I falter and regress to feelings of frustration? Of course, I'm a mom. I'm only human, but no longer will I dwell on it. I will pray for strength and pray for the thanksgiving to God for what I used to see as boring chores, because He knows, He sees, and He has charged me to take great care in the details for the purpose of His kingdom. And I am more than happy to oblige. The peace that passes understanding has now become my song.
peace that passes understanding is my song. I want to say a special thanks to Nicole and Ben for leading us in worship, and also thanks to Courtney for that apt word that she gave us, not just for Mother's Day, but really for every day of the week. So why would we spend so much time carving a bird into a beam that will be covered by a roof? This is a great question, and it's not just a question for mothers on Mother's Day. It's not just a question for parents with busy children, but it's really a question for all of us who are engaged in the work of building the kingdom of God. Why do we do transitional housing? Very few, if any other people, really know what's going on. Why do we serve in North Star Initiative, or serve at the factory, or at Solanco Neighborhood Ministry? Why do we teach kids in Power Hour on Sunday morning? It's just a couple kids that are there, let alone parents or other people to watch what we're doing. You know, why would we mentor or counsel those who struggle with financial planning or pornography or depression or addictions? Why do we distribute food on Beaver Street or clean toilets or sweep the floor maybe at our job? You know, this kind of work gets covered up in the rush of life and superseded by events and activities that are much more glamorous. So why would we do all of this? Do we do it to be noticed? To be recognized? Or do we do it just because we love it? Or do we do it for the sake of accomplishment or the thrill of finishing a project or being able to check off another thing off of our to-do list? Or do we do it just because we are a compassionate person? I want us to take a look at the scriptures that precede what Courtney read. So I want to invite you this morning to turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles or on your phones. And we're going to look at the book of Colossians, chapter 3. I'm going to begin reading at verse 15, and here's how it goes. So let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your heart to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Would you just join me this morning in a prayer? Father God, we thank you that you've given us your word, and you've given us these scriptures that can change our life for eternity. Father, I pray that each word that is spoken, each thought, that your Holy Spirit would work in and through us today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And then the Apostle Paul, he goes on and gives instructions to wives, husbands, children, and to fathers. And then he tells us how to do this. And that's what Courtney was talking about. So what are some of the ways that you have carved birds into the rafters of your life? You know, things that no one sees other than you and God. Stop the video and give this question some consideration. What are these ways that, some of the ways that you have carved birds into the rafters of your life? Let's notice a couple of things as we look at this question, why carve the bird? And I invite you to go to the notes. Why carve the bird? The peace of Christ. So verse 15 reads this way, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace, and be thankful. The word rule here actually means to function like an umpire or a referee. I often share this thought in wedding meditations because people often ask for this text in their ceremony. What does a referee do? Think about that. What does a referee do? Well, he makes the call. Did you ever watch a football or a baseball game, and did you ever see it when the players start arguing with the ref or with the umpire? And who usually wins? You know, it's the official. His call is always right, even when he's wrong. And I want you to know, folks, that Jesus is the ref, and his calls are always right. And there's no point in arguing with him. And when we learn to accept this, we can then learn the principle of true peace. You see, I want you to get this. We have the freedom to carve the birds in our lives because we have this calling to peace, and we have his rule of peace. And his rule of peace empowers us to focus on what is unseen. So therefore, we don't need to be ruled by what is seen and by what is up front and by what others want us to produce. Do you get what I'm saying? So I want you to pause the video for a moment. I want you to think about this question. How does focusing on what is seen by others and by what is up front become a deterrent to peace? In other words, how does it keep us from peace? Timberline, I encourage you to pray and to allow God to make the call so that our focus can be on what is seen, what is unseen, and not by what is seen. Let's go to our notes. Number two, why carve the bird? The word of Christ. Verse 16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your heart to God. The word dwell here in this context means to occupy a house, you know, in the same way that all of us, you know, have a house or an apartment that we need to occupy or to live in the same way we need to allow the word of Christ to live in our lives, kind of like an everyday kind of a thing. When we understand the power of the word of Christ and we make it part of our everyday lives, then we have the confidence to carve birds in places that no one else will ever attempt, because the word of Christ is the most powerful change agent ever. One of the things that I sensed during this lockdown was that this is a great time for self-study. And I wish I would have made more of a focus on this for us here at Timberline over the last 8 weeks. In fact, I regret that I did not give that more focus. You know, we may not be able to meet in large groups right now, or even in small groups, but we can read, and we can self-study, and we can memorize the word of Christ. So in that sense, maybe it's not too late. You know, right now, the Bible memory challenge is Psalms 91. This is the same psalm that Joanna Urison was talking about and was referring to. So I want to challenge you, Timberline, to memorize it. You know, we have the time. You know, we don't need to go out in the evenings. We don't need to go anywhere Sunday morning. We don't need to go to the mall to shop in the afternoon. And we still can't go out to eat. So let the words of this psalm, Psalm 91, sink into our brains. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. We talked about that last week, the value of the shadow, being in the shadow of the Almighty. So how can we meditate on the Word of God, and how can we meditate in a way that will prepare us so that we can be willing to carve birds that are going to be in hiding? Take some time to just meditate on that question. You see, there's no need to be seen by others, to be praised by others, when we consider the shelter and shadow of the Almighty. Let's go to our notes. Why carve the bird? The name of Christ. The name of Christ. Verse 17 says, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. We can carve the bird in the shadow of the Almighty, even when it's covered up by the roof, because the motivation for our actions is the name of Christ, for the glory of God, revealed to us by the Holy Spirit. Jesus once said in John chapter 14, verse 26, "But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." The Apostle Paul wrote, 1 Corinthians 10:31, "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God." And Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11, "If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides." Catch this. So that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. What does it mean to you to do all for the glory of God? Just give that question some consideration. And here is the bottom line. We can carve a bird that no one but God will ever see, because we were created for his purposes, for his honor, for his glory. You see, this is where we need to check in for the day. This is where we find our marching orders. This is where we get our to-do list. We get this all when we live out the purpose of his instructions. Timberline, carve a bird in the hiding this week. Let's pray. All who have ears to hear, those who have eyes to see, do you not recognize the voice of the Almighty? Do you not see the hand of the Lord? Open your hands in prayer. Lift up his name with your voice, for the compassion of your Father calls out. The strength of your King is apparent. All who have ears to hear, learn well the voice of your Sovereign. Those who have eyes to see, recognize the handiwork of your Creator. In times of struggle and confusion, sing kingdom songs and lift your voice in praise as the sun rises and sets. May his name be heard upon every breeze. Timberline, go carve a bird. God bless you.